Ya'ase shalom, ya'ase shalom, shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael.
This week's portion is called Devarim, and it is the first portion of the book of Deuteronomy. And because of that, the first aliyah of this portion begins with the story of Moses' last sermon to his people. These are the words Moses spoke to all Israel in the wilderness east of Jordan. Devarim is the Hebrew word for words, hence Devar Torah means words of Torah. But the word Devar also means thing. The rabbis taught us that this was to remind us that the words we use have a real physical effect on the world, and that we have a responsibility to use them wisely. Words were the building blocks of the Torah's wisdom, and that made them absolutely priceless. Well, I have some unfortunate news for the rabbis. Words are pretty worthless these days. Don't get me wrong, it's not that they're not important. It's just a simple matter of economics. The value of any commodity must necessarily go down when its supply increases. And man, have we been flooded with words lately. Politicians and political pundits and 24-hour cable news and your third cousin's Twitter feed and that girl you had a crush on in high school whose Facebook status updates you always like because you're still flirting with her and don't think she doesn't realize it. We are absolutely inundated with other people's thoughts and opinions. And even those of us that proudly shield ourselves from others' opinions in our own cloud of self-certainty, we love to tell you exactly what's wrong with this country and how we'd fix it if we were in charge. And we're happy to continue telling you what we think until you get sick of us and physically get up and leave the room. And really, all of this self-indulgent discussion would be fine if we weren't still in the habit of pretending that our words were things. There's a website called The Onion that produces satirical newspaper articles. Usually these stories fall somewhere between funny and silly, like attempted murderer gave it his best shot, or new Apple campaign urges consumers to buy iPhone for their other hand. But every rare once in a while, especially after a serious tragedy, The Onion will write a satirical piece that bites back at us. And following the horrific shootings last week in Aurora, Colorado, The Onion wrote a bittersweet article entitled, "Sadly, Nation Knows Exactly How Colorado Shootings Aftermath Will Play Out." I encourage you to read the entire piece, but I'd like to read part of that article now. According to the nation's citizenry, calls for a mature, thoughtful debate about the role of guns in American society started right on time and should persist throughout the next week or so. However, the populace noted, the debate will soon spiral out of control and ultimately lead to nothing of any substance, a fact Americans everywhere acknowledged they felt absolutely horrible to be aware of. With scalpel-like precision, the American populace then went on to predict, to the minute, how long it will take for the media to swarm Aurora, Colorado, how long it will take them for them to leave, exactly when questions will be raised as to whether or not violence in movies and video games had something to do with the act. The nation's citizens also confirmed that, any time now, some religious figure or cable news personality will say something unbelievably insensitive about the tragic shooting. How are we still doing this? And if I may, I'd like to add to those observations my own experiences on Facebook and other online social sites. Having now lived through and experienced the aftermath of tragedies like Columbine and 9/11 and Congresswoman Gifford's shooting and now Aurora, I can tell you how social media will unfold. Dozens of my friends will express shock and outrage and disbelief. They'll tell stories about where they were and how they heard. They'll share tearful photos of victims and their families, and they'll enjoy the satisfaction of pressing like under a friend's message about how guns should either all be banned or all made legal because that would fix everything. They'll explain how this tragedy completely validates what they already believed, hoping that it changed everyone else's mind. And a week later, just before they've forgotten about the tragedy because news has just broken about whoever Jennifer Aniston is dating, they'll sit there staring sedentary into a computer screen in their underwear and declare, "Man, someone ought to do something." Yeah, someone. I want you to think back over the last 30 years or so at the incredible success of breast cancer awareness campaigns. Between marathons and races and t-shirts and buttons and co-branded products, you can't see anything that's pink anymore and not immediately assume it has something to do with breast cancer awareness. If there's one thing we're all certain of, it's that breast cancer definitely exists. Thanks to the breast cancer awareness vodka, Side Pocket Distilleries. That's a real thing, by the way. Now, would it surprise you to know that in the 30 or so years of this massive awareness campaign, the parade of breast cancer has not changed at all? That's right. all of those pink ribbons you wear seem to have do nothing to cure breast cancer. And there are a number of reasons for this, but the primary one seems to be that participation in an awareness campaign makes people less likely to donate actual money. And really, why should they be forced to donate when they're wearing their custom pink Save the Tatas shirt? Now, I will say that as Jews, we have developed an incredible tradition of donating in the face of both joy and tragedy. Our congregation thrives on donations made in memory of friends and loved ones who have died, or to honor the contributions of volunteers, or just to remind our friends and family that we love them. This congregation wouldn't exist without those donations. And yet even we seem to have difficulty translating this impulse into the more secular world. We invest so much time explaining how simple it would be to fix a problem, and exactly no time actually fixing the problem. And this isn't mere sloth. Rather, we have begun to convince ourselves that talk is the same as action, that word means thing. But since I feel that we have the beginnings of a good idea on taking talk and translating it into action, let me challenge you tonight to set this example in the secular world. When a tragedy strikes and your community is paralyzed by confusion and grief, be the first to step up and make a donation to a victim's fund or a hospital. If you can't afford that, then donate your time. Even if you can't affect a change directly, even if the tragedy is half a country away, then a day in a soup kitchen or cleaning a park might show your friends a healthier response than politicizing a tragedy or talking about what ought to be done. And finally, when you do hear someone explain what a simple solution they have that might fix the problem, challenge them as to why they haven't led that charge. Yes, there are obstacles, and no problem complicated enough for such a broad discussion is meant to be solved in a day. But we can begin solving this problem of inertia by acknowledging that words mean nothing. Shabbat Shalom.